Hi, Grandma here, and I'm reading Adam of the Road, and I'm going to begin with chapter 6. And chapter 6 has Adam looking, what do you think he looks like? Do you think he looks like he's happy or sad, anxious, content? The other thing that's interesting is this is called A Blush of Boys, and I have no idea what that means. But if we look at the picture carefully, we can see that there are other boys down here on the other side of the wall that are playing, and he looks very uninterested in playing with them. So he's sad for some reason, maybe. A Blush of Boys. Adam sat on the brick wall of the stable yard and pretended that he was not lonely. Here he was, he told himself, sitting in the sunshine with Nick beside him. Roger was in the house talking to Sir Edmund, and Bayard was in the stable. Why was his heart so heavy? Well, he missed Perkin. That was a courtly sorrow. Roland longed for Oliver, Damon for Pythias, Horn for Atof. History and romance were full of noble friends grieving because they were separated. Shouts and a burst of laughter from the alley behind him, which was used as a tilt yard, stung him to a greater honesty with himself. Even if Perkin had been sitting right there on the wall beside him, still his heart would be heavy because behind and below in the tilt yard was a band of boys his own age having a good time without him. He'd been here nearly 3 days now, and they paid no more attention to him than if he'd been a fly. The first day he'd walked up to them happily and expectantly, and they all, led by Hugh, immediately went somewhere else. Well, that would tell me I was not welcome. The second day, they were nowhere to be seen. Adam stayed with Roger most of the day, learning the singing parts of a new romance from France. Simon was with them for a while, and that had been great joy to Adam. This morning, he'd perched himself up on the wall with his back to the boy so they could see him and call him if they wanted him. He'd played his harp and he'd talked rather loudly to Nick, and then he just sat. Never before had his friendly advances been turned down. Never before had he, Roger the minstrel's son, been ignored. It made him feel very low in his mind. Suddenly, he thought of one of the famous proverbs of Alfred. If thou hast a sorrow, tell it not to thy foe, but whisper it to thy saddle bow and ride forth singing. In other words, don't complain to people who make you sad, but tell it to an inanimate object like a saddle bow and go out singing. He shook himself almost the way Nick did and thought being practically action with Adam, jumped down into the stable yard. A pretty sort of thing he'd been doing, he told himself, sitting up on the wall for all to see his loneliness, when Roger had said he could take Bayard out and give him some exercise. Bayard was a war horse. He was big and broad and strong enough to carry the weight of a man in armor, but he was no fiery steed. He was well past his mettlesome youth, and Roger was satisfied for Adam to ride him. Adam whistled as he sat about saddling and bridling Bayard, and in his struggle with the harness, which was really too big and heavy for him to manage, he forgot about the other boys. A stableman came to his assistance finally and heaved the big saddle onto Bayard's broad back. He shortened the stirrups himself and then mounted by climbing on the edge of the water trough. Just as he was turning around to run right out of the yard, Simon Talbot came through the door in the wall with his lantern in his fist. Adam was pleased to know the word lantern. Some words were like pets to him, and especially these new words that Simon was teaching him. A lantern. And we're going to have a lot of this in this chapter where it's new vocabulary and we have to pay attention because the author pretty much tells us what the new words mean. A lantern was the kind of falcon that a squire was permitted to own. A king had a gerfalcon, a lady like Emily a merlin, and a yeoman a goshawk. Simon had taught Adam II the right words for flocks of different kinds of birds. If you saw, for instance, a number of swallows together, you spoke of a flight of swallows. But you said a walk of snipe and a gaggle of geese. Herd of cattle, a flock of chickens. There are lots of different ways of describing groups of animals. Now Adam sat all eyes and eagerness on Bayard and waited for Simon to note him. Of all the six or seven young squires who served Sir Edmund, Adam most loved and admired Simon. "Ho, Rob," called Simon, "saddle Palmers for me." Palmers was within the stable, whinnied at the sound of his master's voice. The squire stooped to pat Nick and then came over to Adam. He held up his right hand with the heavy leather glove that came nearly to his elbow. On it perched a small hawk with his hooded head hunched down into his feathers and his talons clasped around Simon's wrist. Little leather thongs called Jessies were fastened to the bird's legs and passed between the fingers of Simon's hand. On each leg was a small bell. "I'm going to Westminster," said Simon. "There's a fellow there who's going to let me have a pair of Milanese bells, cheap. "You already have some bells," said Adam. "Oh, I know, but they're not right. One ought to be a semitone higher than the other. Where are you going on your war horse?" "Nowhere special," said Adam breathlessly. Perhaps he thought his heart leaping under the stripes of the surcoat. Perhaps Simon would ask him to go to Westminster with him. "Well, there's a blush of boys out there in the tilt yard. A blush of boys, you remember what I told you. And a what of girls?" "A bevy of girls," answered Adam promptly. "Right. So now we know what a blush of boys is. It's a large group of boys, like a gaggle of geese. Right, well, they're tilting at the quintain on foot because the sorry nag of Hughes is lame. Now, you've got a real war horse. I believe that if you were disposed to be generous with him, they'd be glad to see you. Now, I'm not quite sure what a quintain is, but if they're tilting at it, that means they're charging it with their spears or their lances. Okay. Rob brought out Palmers, all sleek and shining and prancing delicately, and Simon mounted and rode off. Adam turned Bayard and rode slowly out of the yard. He knew that Roger would not mind if the boys rode Bayard, for they all rode as well as Adam did, and some rode better, but he did not know whether he himself was willing to lend his horse to that uppish fellow Hugh. He was quite sure he did not want to offer Bayard to Hugh. "Let him ask politely, for it is a favor." Still undecided, he rode into the tilt yard. Tilt yard was a fancy name for what was just part of a wide alley with a quintain halfway down its length. The quintain was a post with a battered old shield hanging on it. The idea was to strike the shield with a lance in such a way as to knock it to the ground. So it's just what I thought it was. It was much more fun, of course, and much swifter to ride at it on horseback than to run at it on foot. This is how the boys practiced their soldiering skills. Six boys were scattered up and down the alley. Hugh and his younger brothers, Godfrey and Ralph, who were nephews of Sir Edmund, William and Martin, the sons of the falconer, and Matthew, the bailiff's son. Adam tumbled himself down from Bayard and set off handedly to Godfrey, who was shorter, blunter, and much jollier looking than Hugh. "Why don't you ride at the quintain? You can have Bayard if you like." Godfrey looked at him uncertainly for a moment and then gave a shrill shout. "Hugh, come here. Minstrel's son says we can ride Bayard." Hugh, who was halfway down the alley, turned and came back, carrying the blunt-end ashwood pole that he used for a lance. For the second time, he and Adam looked squarely at each other. Well, sir, Adam was saying within himself, I don't care so very much for you, but I like your crowd and I want to belong to it. I'll do my share and a bit over. Now, he didn't say that out loud. That was to himself. What Hugh was thinking behind those rather glittery blue eyes of his, Adam could not tell. Hugh's glance wavered first. He turned to Bayard, and Adam knew from the way he looked at the horse and touched him that Hugh loved Bayard almost as much as Adam loved Nick. He's getting old, said Hugh, but he's a great horse still. He was in battle at Acre in the Holy Land. Uncle got him in exchange for a white Spanish jennet, and he was sorry afterwards because he liked the jennet better. But I'd rather have Bayard any day. So a jennet is just a small Spanish horse. He mounted nimbly, and Ralph handed his lance up to him. Two of the boys ran to raise the shield higher on the post. Nobody questioned Hugh's right to the first turn. Godfrey said to Adam while Hugh was riding Bayard up and down to get the feel of him again, Hugh thought maybe Uncle would give Bayard to him, but he didn't. Then Adam understood why Hugh had been so disagreeable. Suppose somebody else had got Nick. By St. Simon, he said, copying Simon Talbot, I'm sorry. Some other horse would have done as well for Roger. Time was when they didn't have a horse at all. Hugh rode twice at the Quintain. The first time he missed, but the second time he sent the shield clattering to the ground. Then Godfrey had his turn, and Hugh, glowing, came to talk to Adam. He looked a different boy. All the ill humor seemed to have been shaken out of him. Will Roger let you have Bayard again? He asked eagerly. Oh, I'm sure he will when I tell him. I mean, you ride better than I do, so if he'd let me, he'd let you. Hugh watched Godfrey critically. He'll miss. You'll see. He's good, but Bayard doesn't like him as well as he likes me. Bayard and I understand each other. At Ludlow, we've got a real tilt yard, and the Quintain isn't just a shield. It's a wooden Saracen on a pivot with a sword in his hand. Now, a Saracen is the enemy of the Crusaders in the Holy Land. The Saracens were, today we would call them Arabic, they were Muslims, and so the Christians were fighting them in the Holy Lands. So in at Ludlow, they have not just a shield that you could hit at with your lance, but a wooden looking man who represented the Saracens. Okay. If you hit him in the middle of the forehead, he falls over. But if you hit him anywhere else, he swings around and whacks you in the back with his sword. By St. Hugh, that's a real tilting. Godfrey came back and declaring that Ralph, who was not yet 10, was too small, Hugh sent Martin off next and then William. Do you want a turn? He thought at last to say to Adam. Hugh cried Godfrey reproachfully, it's his horse. Hugh blushed. Oh, well, he said, trying to cover his confusion. Minstrels don't joust or ride in tournaments or go to war. Well, Taillefer did, said Adam stoutly. He was the conqueror's minstrel, but he was a warrior too. At the Battle of Senlac, he asked leave of William to begin the onset, and he rode before the whole army, juggling with his sword, chanting the song of Roland. Then he rushed on the English and was killed. So Adam had his turn. Before he went to St. Albans, he had had some practice here and there. Mostly, it's true, one Easter in London. He had not done badly then. It gave him confidence to remember that. He cradled his lance in his arm and he spoke to Bayard. Nearer and nearer the shield they came. Adam gathered himself together and thrust, and the battered dingy shield dropped to the ground and wobbled over on its face. Trying not to grin too broadly, Adam rode back to the others. He could not keep his head from wagging a bit. "Well done," said Hugh with respect in his voice. He had been kneeling on one knee and holding Nick's collar while Adam rode. Now he stood up and said, dusting off his knee very briskly, "This is a good dog, Adam. He's got a fine ear carriage and a straight back. We haven't got any dogs at Ludlow any better than he, at least not any spaniels." So the one thing that really made Adam angry was when Hugh said that all of their dogs back in Ludlow were better than Nick. And he thought that was unfair. So now Hugh is basically apologizing. It was wonderful how much better that made Adam feel. After Matthew had had his first turn and Hugh his second, the shadow of the pear tree reached the wall and it was time to stop. That's how they tell time, is the shadows. Adam led Bayard back to the stable and the others went off toward the house with their heads together. In a moment, Godfrey left them and came running back to Adam. "We've a sort of company, we six, when we're in London," he panted. "Hugh and I are knights, and Ralph's a squire, and Will and Matthew and Martin are yeomen, and Marjorie is our liege lady. We've never had a minstrel, but Hugh says we need one, and we all think so. You could be Taillefer." So he has been accepted into this group of boys. After that, they were together every minute that they could be. None of the seven went to school. Sir Edmund's three nephews considered learning only for milksops who were not fit to be knights, or for poor boys like Perkins, whose sole hope of advancement was through the church. But they were all subject to instruction of one kind or another from grown-ups. Hugh and Godfrey and Ralph had a tutor who trained them in pursuits necessary for boys who look forward to being knights. Tilting and riding and swordplay and hawking and hunting. They had a great deal of tiresome practicing to do, the same exercises over and over again with very little praise to sweeten it, and even less sympathy if they got tired. The falconer's boys were often busy in the mews where the molting hawks were kept, and they had to learn how to make hoods and jessies out of skins and how to school the young hawks and to care for the ailing ones. Matthew, the bailiff's son, must struggle with figures and learn to cast accounts and to know what was expected of everybody in a large and complicated household like Sir Edmund's. As for Adam, he had work too. The northern minstrels were famous for singing together, one in the bass and the other in the treble. Roger had brought home new songs from France, which Adam must learn, and they had many old ones to practice as well. And Adam had his harping to work on too, and Roger taught him to do some new tumbling tricks and to juggle knives. "It's not real minstrelsy, but it catches the crowd," said Roger. "Some people can't appreciate a good story well told, but they like to have a little young lad dazzle their slow eyes with tricks. You needn't use them unless you have to, but it's well to have a second string to your bow." What he's saying is it's good to have something in your back pocket if whatever's in your, you know, is not working, to have another weapon or another skill to use. When they were free to be together, the seven boys had endless fun. They were tilting at the quintain or diving and swimming in the river or running foot races or having wrestling matches. In the long twilights after supper, they played games in the garden, and Marjorie and Emily and some of the squires would join them. They played prisoner's base and hoop and hide and hoodsman's blind, and when the girls insisted, London Bridge. I played London Bridge when I was a little girl. Adam would play on his harp for that, and his voice soared high above the others in the singing. "London Bridge is broken down, dance over my Lady Lee. London Bridge is broken down with a gay lady." The joke of it was, though, the song was such an old one and the wooden London Bridge had fallen down more than 100 years before and built back up, stone so strong, it was likely to come true again. For years and years, the old Queen Eleanor had collected fees from all who passed over it and never spent a penny of them on repairs. Now the stones were worn into holes in some of the arches so that you could see the water rushing beneath. Build it up with silver and gold, dance over my Lady Lee. Build it up with silver and gold with a fair lady. The ones inside the ring would sing, and those on the outside would sing, silver and gold will be stolen away, dance over my Lady Lee. Silver and gold will be stolen away with a gay lady. Adam would twang his harp and look across the beds of roses and gillyflowers and lilies to the river and London Bridge, misty in the distance with a faint light or two in the windows and the houses on it. A bridge is a kind of sacred thing, he thought, as Roger said a road was. There was a chapel to St. Thomas of Canterbury in the middle of London Bridge, and St. Thomas was a great saint, and his chapel was holy. Yet the old queen had not cared enough about the bridge to keep it safe. And boys and girls never gave it a thought when they sang joyfully, London Bridge is broken down with a gay lady. We never sang it quite that way. It was London Bridge is falling down, falling down, falling down. London Bridge is falling down, my fair lady. So we didn't say gay lady, we said fair lady. Bye-bye.